Welcome. Good afternoon, everyone. I would like to open the public hearing of the New York State Agricultural Committee on the issue of cruelty to companion animals by thanking everyone for joining us today. I'm joined by my colleague on the Agricultural Committee, Senator Valesky, and also Senator Griffo, whose home district this is. And I'd like to thank Senator Griffo for inviting me today to deal with this important issue. Due to time constraints, today's testimony is by invitation only, but I would like to tell anyone in the audience, if you're interested in submitting comments, suggestions, please feel free to submit your written testimony to my office, either in Watertown or in Albany, and we certainly would appreciate it, and we'll check each submitted testimony in, and we will respond and let you know the progress we're making. So thank you for coming today. Today we will hear testimony from law enforcement and from the American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, ASPCA, and what New York can do to strengthen the laws and to help law enforcement combat the issues of cruelty to animals. I know many of you in the audience here, this is an issue when it comes up that is near and dear to your heart, something that is very emotional. So I appreciate each and every one of you for taking the time out of your schedule today to come down and listen to the testimony. Many of the animal cruelty bills, they actually end up in the Agricultural Committee, and from that committee, many are forwarded on to the Codes Committee. So it's important that each bill that comes in, we have the opportunity to discuss them and to forward them on to the committee for the committee's feedback. Because it deals with the Ag and Markets Law, we did invite the commissioner, and his staff was unavailable today. This year we have had a number of bills just recently over the last 2 weeks that have been forwarded through the committee. I have with me my committee director from Albany, Todd Kuzniers, and he is just going to read briefly the four bills that we have recently passed and some of the details to go along with it.
Thank you very much, Senator. The first bill that we reported out of the Agriculture Committee this year was a measure sponsored by Senator Ritchie, Senate Bill 6774. It's also carried in the State Assembly by Assemblymember John McEnany. And this measure essentially specifies that any person who intentionally owns, sells, manufactures animal the intent to otherwise promote or facilitate animal fighting is guilty of a Class B misdemeanor, which the fines are also increased with this piece of legislation. And just last week in the Senate Ag Committee, there were four other bills that were reported out, and I'll just briefly touch on those. The first one is Senate Bill 5083, sponsored by Senator Ball. It's being carried in the Assembly by Assemblymember Tedesco. And this measure specifies that a person is guilty of aggravated cruelty to animals when in the course of the commission of a felony or in the immediate flight therefrom, such person causes physical injury or death to a companion animal. Also another measure sponsored by Senator Ball, which was reported out of committee, is Senate Bill 5084, also carried by Assemblymember Tedesco in the Assembly. And this measure is supported by a New York State Bar Association. This measure prohibits a person convicted of aggravated cruelty to animals from owning or possessing a companion animal unless authorized by a court order after an appropriate psychiatric or psychological testing, which indicates that there's clear and convincing evidence that the person is capable and has sound mental capacity and ability to own and properly care for that animal in a humane manner. Another measure that was reported out of committee last week, Senate Bill 5702A by Senator Klein. That's being carried in the Assembly by Assemblymember Paulin. This measure prohibits the use of cage or box dryer at a companion animal grooming facility, which contains a heating element with the heating element turned on for the purpose of drying or aiding in the drying of a companion animal. And the final bill, which I believe the Nassau District Attorney's Office may touch on this afternoon, is Senate Bill 6730, which is sponsored by Senator Fusillo. It's being carried in the Assembly by Assemblyman Member Rosenthal. And essentially, it's a very long bill, but it clarifies, modernizes, and restructures the animal cruelty laws, certain sections of the Ag and Markets Law into the penal law. And it does a host of other things, redefining terms, increasing penalties, and I think we'll let the District Attorney's Office maybe touch on that a little bit more later. It's a measure that was reported out of the Ag Committee. New York Farm Bureau opposes it in its current form, but we've been working with the sponsor on that measure, and the sponsor is working to address many of the concerns that Farm Bureau has on that. So those are the bills for this session so far.
Thank you, Todd. One of the largest categories of animal abuse classification is neglect by an owner, and I'm actually here today by invitation from Senator Griffo because of the horrific case that happened. Griffo, I thank you for the invitation. I appreciate the opportunity to get feedback from law enforcement so we can put in place a law on the books to help you do your job. Senator Valesky, did you want to make any comments before we hear testimony?
Sure, just briefly. As you have all heard, the Senate Agriculture Committee under the outstanding leadership of Senator Ritchie has already been very active in the area of animal abuse. That we have taken in the committee and hopefully we'll be taking at the level of the entire Senate and the Assembly as that you may have to come forward with so that Senator Ritchie and I and others on the committee can make sure that we have the toughest laws on the books in New York State that we certainly ought to have. So, Senator, thank you for being here, and certainly, Senator Griffo, it's always great to be with you in your Senate district. Thank you.
Senator Griffo, do you want to elaborate on the tragic case and your perspective on this important issue? Once again, thank you for bringing it to the forefront, inviting me here today.
Chairwoman, Senator Ritchie, I want to first thank both of my colleagues here because I'm fortunate that I have the opportunity to serve with both of my colleagues and share coverage with them in both the North Country with Senator Ritchie and here in the Central Mohawk Valley region with Senator Valesky. So I'm very fortunate to have two colleagues that our respective regions. I want to also commend Senator Ritchie, as Senator Valesky did, for her exceptional leadership. She has done an extraordinary job during her short tenure as chair of the Agriculture Committee. We appreciate your work and efforts and her responsiveness, too. As Senator Ritchie indicated, I was not only alarmed but disgusted by the acts of cruelty that we witnessed, unfortunately, in our area here. But it doesn't only take place here. It takes place across the state. So anytime, and I approached Senator Ritchie with support from Senator Valesky and our other colleagues with the idea of holding a public hearing. And I want to emphasize the significance of holding a standing committee public hearing of the Senate. It shows that we attach in dealing with problems as we have witnessed not only here in the central New York area but across the state. You know, I look at this and anyone who treats a living thing with this callous disregard and downright cruelty really disgusts me, and it is need for us to call attention and to put in place appropriate measures that may be necessary in order to help law enforcement and the prosecutors do their job, and also to get the perspective from many of you who are involved in animal advocacy. So, Senator Ritchie, again, thank you for your willingness to put this hearing together so we could hear the oral testimony that we will hear today, but also anyone here can submit written testimony. So as we in Albany begin to deliberate and determine the best course of action to deal with the subject matter, we will have input from the community across the state. So I thank you again for the opportunity to host you here today, and again appreciate the significance and importance that we're placing on the subject matter by your interest in holding the hearing.
Thank you, Senator. If we could have the first two speakers come up to the table. Jed Painter, Assistant District Attorney of the Animal Crimes Unit, Nassau County DA's Office. And thank you for making the long trip up. Mm-hmm. And Scott McNamara, Oneida County District Attorney.
Thank you, Senator.
Okay. And Chief, do you want to make testimony today, too? Do you have any comments?
Yes.
I'll have you come right up then, too, please. Thank you.
Sorry, sir.
And Jed said you had the farthest ride. We'll let you open up here, so.
Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you very much for the invitation. It was a pleasure to drive that far to be here, and I'm really happy to be on this and privileged to be on this panel to the left and right of me. My name is Jed Painter. I am Chief of the Animal Crimes Unit for the Nassau County District Attorney's Office. A little bit about Nassau County. Its population is approximately 1.4 million people. It is a metropolitan area prosecutor's office, borders Queens, and so we get a lot of overflow of dogfighting activity. We also get a little bit more rural, to the east where we border Suffolk County. So we do have a variety of animal crime to deal with. And like all metropolitan area district attorney's offices or larger district attorney's offices, we're subdivided into bureaus and units, sex crimes, vehicular crimes, environmental crimes, tech crimes. And at some point along the way, that point being 2010 specifically, at the beginning of it, D.A. Rice decided that animal crime was a legitimate category of crime, which it absolutely is, and as a law enforcement strategy decided to dedicate a unit to it. And at the time, it did make waves, but I think it's common sense. I think it's logical. You have an entire category of crime. Why not, if you're subdividing into bureaus and units, have an animal crimes unit for specialized expertise? Now the animal crimes unit has myself as chief. There's four ADAs who staff it. There's in-house detectives who staff it. There's support staff. There's a 24-hour hotline and internet complaint system that's manned, and it goes right to a prosecutor. And in addition to that proactive work, we also take whatever municipal law enforcement brings us. So whether it be one of our county police officers or city police officers or anybody within our county, we'll take and prosecute that as well. I learn a lot more from the cases we don't make. We've had approximately 1,500 complaints in the last 2 years. Made about 50 to 60 cases, about 25% of those felonies. But again, it's the constant pop quizzes that come in on the hotline, answered by a prosecutor and eventually reviewed by myself, that developed the most interesting legal education. And I believe a lot of that, again, I won't hog all the time by talking about Senate Bill 6730, but a lot of that was tried to be incorporated. A lot of the issues were tried to be corrected in Senate Bill 6730. Apart from serving as chief of the Animal Crimes Unit, I also work in Public Corruption Bureau, where I investigate political entities and public officials for corruption. It's good to be in an investigative bureau like that because I now can avail myself of an investigative grand jury at all times. I find that helpful when it comes to investigating complex things like dog fighting rings or other types of enterprise cruelty, of which there's a big problem if one pays attention. It is interesting, though, and I will put this to the committee right now, that as much work as I could do investigating a dog fighting ring and possibly getting a warrant if I know a fight's in progress and raiding the dog fighting ring with law enforcement members, if they find a certain amount of drugs on the table or one gun that's loaded, all of a sudden that's the top charge and not the dog fighting. There's a little bit of a disparity in the ways the laws are currently structured that does make it interesting to me to me, in my opinion, that the majority of animal cruelty is, even the highest level, is an unclassified felony. Penal law provisions make it an E felony, but with the special sentencing caps in place in the agriculture markets law, it's even a lesser E felony. And I'll give you an example. A standard E felony would be 1 1/3 to 4 years, indeterminate sentence as a max sentence. Aggravated cruelty to animals, 353-A, is a felony, and it could be characterized as a Class E felony. However, there's a special sentencing cap making it 2 years incarceration. So even there, it's a facade of a penalty. And again, I think also by housing this category of crime outside of the agriculture markets law, outside of the penal law, in the agriculture markets law, does seem to disassociate that logical connection that this is a category of crime, just like economic crime, sex crime, or vehicular crime. That takes place on an ideological level, but also by its disassociation with the penal law, it functions on a practical level. Matters such as fingerprinting are not standardized. In fact, misdemeanor dogfighting is not a printable offense. A lot of misdemeanors that are contained in the agriculture markets law are not printable. And now with the new legislation that's passed about DNA, none of that's taken. Standard things like record keeping, reporting to the state, reporting convictions to DCJS, all these things, just by its absence, shoulder to shoulder with other laws, are lacking. And finally, besides that legal aspect, there's another practical aspect that I can't speak for all police departments, but I do know from slight experience that it's not very common for an average patrol officer to have a copy of the agriculture markets law in their glove compartment of the patrol car. And if they find it, it's not even common in my experience for a desk officer back at the precinct to have one, and then they end up Googling it, and that's a horrible thing if it's that unavailable and inaccessible. If you're lucky enough to find it, yeah, its text, which began in 1826, I believe, is still very much a 19th century dialect. And after combing through a few pages of am I permitted to justifiably run a horse on a plank road or sell baby chicks that have been imparted in an artificial color, after a few combs through that, if the police officer can't find it fast enough to respond to the urgent situation, you might then I completely understand if a warning is given rather than an arrest. It might dissuade actual action on some less urgent or I'll call more garden variety situations of neglect. I think it should be the goal that laws should be written that a average police officer on patrol should be able to find the law, understand the law, and apply the law all in the middle of the night at a crime scene within moments. And I believe right now the laws aren't written that way. So my office, District Attorney Rice, and Senator Fusillo, and Assemblywoman Rosenthal have put forward this Senate Bill 6730A9917. And revisions are going as we work out the kinks, but we put forward this bill for exactly that purpose. And so I'm happy to take questions on it, and thank you very much for hearing me out.
Thank you. You mentioned that there were 1,500 complaints. Out of the complaints, how many individuals were actually prosecuted?
Yes, ma'am.
At the end?
Yes. In the past, in 2011, we had 23 successful arrests out of approximately 600 complaints. Keep in mind that we keep track of all the data. We track our database so we are able to cross-check addresses. So many of those complaints might have been multiple complaints against the same address.
Mm-hmm.
And we allow callers to be anonymous. The virtue of that is, in situations of neglect, we encourage business, so to speak, and we get a lot of business from ex-wives reporting ex-husbands, nephews reporting uncles, and things happening within the household. I think, as anybody can tell you on this panel, that most of animal crime happens in a very constitutionally protected place. It happens behind closed doors, and the victim can't call 911, and getting through that barrier is very difficult. So we encourage anonymous complaints. But that doesn't necessarily mean they're going to take it to the next level and testify. But it's better that we know about it and can cross-check it, and possibly even if the law allows us to intervene or check it out for ourselves, our detective's eyes or municipal law enforcement's eyes can take the place of the witness's eyes. As long as we're ready and dedicated to do surveillance, or if it's a matter of a neglected animal in the backyard that's in plain view, then we just substitute ourselves for the witness. We take them out of the equation. We proceed that way. So there is going to be a huge gap between the amount of complaints that we get and the amount of arrests we can make. That's just the name of the game with a victim that can't talk. I can't tell you how many times I've actually almost gotten to the point of craziness where I've actually wanted to talk to the dog and see, you know, who did this to you? Who tied you to the stop sign? And where'd you get that scar? And how long has this person had you? And is this the person who did it? Because there's always the deniability when the victim can't speak. And it's simple things that you take for granted. You know, I wasn't always an animal crimes prosecutor. I came up through the ranks like every other prosecutor. I prosecuted assaults and things like that. You take it for granted that if somebody's assaulted, they can point out their accuser in court. You're never going to have that luxury with animal crime. So you have to fill in the gaps from around.
Do you see that as an increase, the 1,500 complaints? Is that an increase in recent years, or?
My personal belief, and I'm not a statistician, my personal belief is that people are just becoming more attuned to this as an issue. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you if there's been a rise in cruelty, but I can tell you there's definitely been a rise in the level of awareness.
Senator Griffel or Valesky, do you have any questions?
I actually, Jed, you talked about, I'd be interested in the best approach that you would recommend, and I applaud the DA for her initiatives and your willingness to travel to be a part of this. Said that you would like to have law enforcement find, understand, and apply. What would be the best way to do that? Would it be to equip them with, you know, something in vehicles, or do you have an idea of how that should be accomplished?
Well, two things come to mind when you say that, Senator. First is just the simple transplant of crimes from the agriculture markets law to the penal law. If they're patrol scenario crimes and not the more commercial type provisions that maybe a state agency is enforcing, like railway transport for horses, for example. If you take the more patrol-oriented crimes, codify those in the penal law, I believe that will have a much enhanced effect at police academy training. Other witnesses on this panel will be more apt to answer these questions, but most police academies do focus on vehicle and traffic law and penal law training. Now, granted, there are crimes outside of the penal law. There's tax law crimes. But I can't think of an urgent tax law crisis that requires a radio dispatch and immediate action. That's usually something that can be handled calmly at a desk. A lot of these cases with dog fighting in progress or severe neglect or something that requires immediate intervention, that's not a tax law crime. That's something that a patrolman or patrolwoman needs to be equipped with immediately to act on. Now, as you were speaking, you indicated a certain computer system. An anecdote that I'm hoping that the Senate might take up is pursuant to Agriculture and Markets Law, Section 374.8c, used to be 5c, but it's 8c now for the most current copy. A court, upon conviction for an animal crime, is permitted to sentence the abuser to not have any contact, possession, or control of animals for a time period which the court deems reasonable moving forward. Farm animals are excluded, but in general, a convicted animal abuser can be barred from having any non-farm animal for a period of time which the court deems reasonable. Recently, and only in maybe the last year, we developed a protocol with our local county PD that when we get that order from a court after a conviction, which is a written order just like an order of protection, the county PD will enter it into our local chief's system, which sends something out to a radio car. It's the same system that they check for an order of protection. So they're responding to a situation of domestic violence or really anything at any address, and they run the address in their due diligence as an officer. Usually they'll see, oh, there's an order of protection in effect for this household. I might make an arrest on that. Or they'll see now order of protection against animals for residents of that household. And that's how they might uncover it ancillary to other purposes. in conversations with my chief clerk and various other chief clerks, there's no statewide clearinghouse for that order to be entered in the NYSPIN system. So while it's a statewide order, if you're convicted in Nassau and I have a great order against you that I got after a hard-fought case, and it's entered in my county system, which is the most I can do right now, there's no procedure to get it into the NYSPIN system that I'm aware of currently, and I believe that's as simple as a memo to the clerk's office or OCA. So when you made that radio call remark, that's something that rang a bell.
We don't know, and maybe the chief can answer this eventually too, relative to the level of incidents, whether there is an actual increase that are being reported, but you says you do believe there is greater awareness. So as a result of that, do you believe there's a greater and a heightened need for intervention than there has been in the past?
I do believe as the public sensibility has changed, we owe it to the public to respond accordingly. Now, there's always going to be this philosophical and subjective component to animal crime that makes it unlike any other type of crime. I give the example that murder is, with the exception of self-defense, murder is wrong. Rape is wrong. Arson is wrong. Killing an animal is wrong unless, and then you start all these exemptions, hunting and fishing and slaughtering for human consumption and various things like that. There's no unlesses with other crimes that allow for some subjectivity going on. And it really is the only type of crime where the legislature has hard and fast put forward a definition of animal that includes every living creature except a human being. And then 353, which says it's a crime to unjustifiably kill or unjustifiably injure any animal. So the legislature has made it absolutely clear that all animals are protected. Practically, though, for many reasons, if I give the example of a patrolman sees somebody squash a spider on the street and actually stops the patrol car and goes up to the person and says, "Why'd you just squash that spider?" The person says, "I don't like spiders. That's why I killed it." Now, the officer has just seen the unjustified killing of an animal, and he's elicited a confession. He's got great evidence. Why isn't he not arresting? And it goes back to this public sentiment comes first. First, would the public even report such a thing behind closed doors if you saw your friend kill a spider in your own household when it's a protected animal? Would they call the police on you? Would the police then come? Would the police then arrest? Would a prosecutor then not laugh it off? Would a judge then not throw it out on a Clayton motion? And then would a jury even convict on it? When the legislature has given that spider the same protection by their blanket language as a turtle or a dog. So there's a subjective level to criminal law enforcement that makes this area of crime a little bit more difficult than everything else that can be so objective. And this whole thing about public awareness, it's the public sentiment. It's really the jury nullification. Does the public care about the species of animal, and also the species of animal in a specific situation? Because there are some times when it's your pet gerbil, and sometimes it's a feeder mouse to a snake, or something you set out a mouse trap for. So it's not even species-driven. It's even social mores and local customs and where was the animal at this certain time to make it unjustified killing. It's very difficult. It's very difficult to assess where the public sentiment is at any given time. But that's as specific as I can be. As the public sentiment evolves, so does law enforcement.
Thank you.
Well, that definitely shows how hard it must be to deal with this. Just for my own knowledge, if you were called out on a complaint, when are you allowed to pick up the animals? What do you need to actually witness in order to take the animals out of the house?
There's a few things that are at play there. I almost entirely ignore the Agriculture and Markets Law's provisions for seizure of animals. I go back to Article 690, the criminal procedure law, with warrants. And I go to the emergency exceptions to the warrant requirement. There's many state courts and many federal courts that have concretely held that the rescue of an animal is an emergency exception to the warrant requirement. So if you see an animal being tortured or severely neglected, it needs emergency medical intervention, and I get that call as the prosecutor and the police officer is asking for guidance, I'm telling them to seize the animal right away. And I'll back it up in court that it was a public safety seizure, that the primary because it was. Their primary goal was not to commence a criminal investigation, but to rescue an obviously distressed animal. If it doesn't get to that point where they don't feel that urgency, I might then just go to a judge and get a warrant to make things very, to just make sure I'm covered. I have had situations where I've gotten one warrant to seize an animal, and then I had to get a second warrant to examine the animal after it died because it was just too far gone. And once a living animal turns to a dead animal, the law regards all animals as property, and examination of the interior of a dog is no different than a warrant to power on a cell phone and search its contents. So I, in that one case, in a matter of 24 hours, I had to seek two warrants. And then, even with those two warrants that I got to play it by the book, I still got a motion from defense counsel for spoliation of evidence that I had destroyed evidence in bad faith. Because once the necropsy was completed on the animal, I had two options from the lab. It was to group cremation or sole cremation. I chose sole cremation, but either way, the defense attorney made an apt argument that I destroyed evidence that he could then not analyze. And the judge agreed with him, saying that, I could have kept it in a refrigerator and not examined the animal further to make a stronger case about the abuse that was going on to the animal. I've also had, and I got to tell you, the way the criminal procedure law is written, it's not written to handle the living evidence. So I got to hand it to the defense attorney. It was a smart argument to make. And another smart argument that I've seen happen is on a case where a person shot a dog in the head with a shotgun. Had no justification for doing it, at least that was the theory of my case. When the police showed up, he alleged simply, it bit me on the hand. He had no injury, but he said he bit me. Because of the statement that the dog had bitten him, pursuant to the law, they had to chop the dog's head off and send it to Albany for rabies testing. And that destroyed my evidence, and it also ultimately really impacted the case. Because once again, the state, not the defendant, the state had destroyed evidence. So again, there's a lot of these technical issues that criminal law was not designed very well in handling living evidence. I gained most of my case law from customs, from when illegal plants come in through the border, and they are destroyed by border patrol agents and things like that. Things that can't remain static. A gun will remain static on a shelf. A bag of cocaine will more or less remain static on a shelf. An animal has financial issues, and you don't want to keep it static. As law enforcement, if I'm seizing an animal, it's because something's very, very wrong with that animal. It's sick, or it's starved, or it was stabbed 9 times, or it was shot in the face, and I want to help it. It's my goal to change the status of that evidence, not to preserve it in state. And issues come up with that.
And I just have one follow-up question. If you have a warrant, or if you go out to a house and there's a complaint against the individual for one animal, if you see any other animals in the house, are you able to confiscate all the animals or just the one specifically the complaint has been about?
It depends on the situation. It depends greatly on the situation. But my general inclination would be to, for a lot of reasons, I haven't seen a case like that in a while, but my inclination would be to get a seizure order for the one animal and then do an impound in place order for the remaining animals. And the impound in place order, which is sometimes used a lot in farm animals when you really don't have the facilities to move them. There is a provision of the law that allows a judge to order that during the pendency of a criminal case, a law enforcement entity or an SPCA or the state can go to the person's house and check on the status of the other animals. It doesn't foreclose a warrant at a later date, but it also is an order against the defendant to maintain their health and comfort during the pendency of the criminal action. So financially for a municipality, it's a benefit to have one of those orders because now they're not boarding 13 different animals. It doesn't foreclose a warrant at a later date. And also if the person does progress or neglect those animals, then they're arrested for contempt as well as arrested again for more counts of animal cruelty.
Thank you very much.
Scott,
did you want to?
Sure. First, I would like to thank the committee for inviting me here to speak today about this very important issue. As most people in this room and at least two of the senators are aware, we've had some pretty horrific crimes here locally involving the mistreatment and murder of animals. Typically in such cases, I'm flooded, and I don't use that word lightly, but flooded with emails suggesting that we take the crime serious, that we prosecute it to its maximum, and also ask for the maximum punishment. I'm also typically confronted with emails that suggest different forms of corporal punishment and even the death penalty. Obviously, everyone knows that's not legal, but that's how emotional these cases become. I'm going to limit my comments really to companion animals, as that's what I understand what this is about, so I won't talk about farm animals. As some of you know, I was raised on a local dairy farm. I presently own a dog. I consider myself an animal-friendly person. I'm trying to break this down and make it as simple as I can. I strongly believe right now that our laws minimize the value of an animal's life. Often within our laws, the legislature has thrown in elements that make prosecution difficult, if not sometimes impossible. So let me just kind of tell you how I would suggest if you could look at it. I agree with, it's Jed, right?
Jed.
I agree with Jed about moving it to the penal law. I would also suggest that you break it down the same as we do people. That we first of all make a crime of causing physical injury to an animal, a companion animal is what we're talking about. And the next thing, that we make a separate crime of causing serious physical injury to a companion animal. And then finally, making the most serious crime, causing death, intentionally causing death to a companion animal. Right now, the difficulty that our office has when we have these cases, and I can't really talk about the facts of the case, but there's a case pending right now involving six dogs, is proving the felony level crime, which most people think should be happening. And under the felony level crime, as you're all aware of, aggravated cruelty to animals, we have to prove within that section of the law aggravated cruelty. It's not enough that we can prove that a person intentionally takes the life of a companion animal. We have to additionally prove aggravated cruelty. Under that, we have to prove that they intended to cause extreme physical pain, and also it was done in a depraved and sadistic manner. So the mere fact that somebody intentionally kills a companion animal doesn't do the trick. And let me give you a fact pattern. My dog gets loose, runs next door, and my neighbor takes out his shotgun and shoots and kills my dog. Right now, that crime would have to be prosecuted as a misdemeanor. Most likely we would look at it as some sort of property crime, being a criminal mischief type of level crime. Now we're getting into the value of my dog, trying to determine whether or not what the value would be. So we're not looking at it like we would that we're talking about an actual living animal that was killed. And in that situation, it would be difficult, and I submit to you, impossible to prove the extreme physical pain or the depraved and sadistic manner. Because the problem with the law as it's written right now in the ag and markets, you haven't defined a lot of these terms. So ultimately, we have to fall back on the definitions that are in the penal law, which apply to people, and those definitions don't support a one-shot killing to justify that level of a crime. I'll give a perfect example of a case we had here locally, which I'm sure some people are familiar with. A few years ago, we had a gentleman in the town of Kirkland who got mad at his wife. He took his wife's dog down into the basement of their house. He shot and killed it. His intent was to hurt his wife, to hurt her feelings, which clearly he did. He also killed an innocent animal for no other reason than out of anger. And when it came time for us to prosecute that case, the problem we had was proving the extreme physical pain, because it was a one-shot situation where the dog died immediately. That, to me, defies the logic of the crime that he committed. I mean, it's a very unnecessary crime. I don't know why we should have to prove the aggravated cruelty. And if we're going to prove aggravated cruelty, I would submit to you, then make that a higher level crime. But give us a felony level crime of intentionally killing a companion animal without justification or necessity. And I say the justification and necessity, obviously, I think some of you know what I'm talking about, but justification would be, you know, obviously the self-defense situation where the dog is attacking you, or necessity if the dog had rabies and it was necessary. But I really think if we broke this down and just made it a lot simpler, right now the ag and market law is very difficult to read, and I agree. The police don't typically have that on them, and we could make this a lot easier and also provide rights to our animals, and also provide rights to the owners of these animals that currently don't seem to be there. A couple other things I just wanted to touch upon, which I won't go into a great amount of detail. You know, obviously defining the words that are in that ag and market law would be very beneficial to us, so that we don't have to guess or rely upon a court's interpretation. And another thing that is a concern of ours, and especially in my office and the prosecutor that handles a lot of these cases, because these are under the ag and market law, they don't apply for second felony offender, they don't apply for, as was said before, they don't apply for DNA, and some don't even apply for fingerprinting. So, you know, those are the type of things that we need to look at, because if we have somebody who has a long history of criminal conduct, and it's all under the penal law, and then he goes out and intentionally kills his neighbor's dog for no reason, other than just because he felt like being mean, we're left with a relatively minor crime with very little punishment available to us. And honestly, the public doesn't understand that. They do not understand when I try to explain to them, you know, that the law doesn't provide for more protection for companion animals. So that's what I would, you know, just ask you to consider and to push forward, because, you know, as the law is written right now, it's very difficult for us to prosecute. And honestly, you know, it's written as was explained with enough loopholes in it that a good defense attorney, as we saw recently in a case here involving a dog that was shot three times and killed, good defense attorney doesn't really have a problem getting somebody acquitted on these type of charges.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you have any questions?
Scott, when you talk about it being minimized right now, do you believe there are a number of ideas, and that's one of the reasons to conduct the hearing too, that are out there right now, is DA Rice has some suggestions and there are other members who have ideas. Do you think the best means to accomplish this would be through strengthening some of the existing laws or looking at new laws? And then where is that best placed? I know I heard something saying maybe out of ag and markets and into, you know, another aspect of the criminal code. I mean, what is the best way? Should we strengthen what we have, and or should we look to some new things that have to be done? And then where's the best place?
I can only speak for myself. I would like to see it move to the penal law, and I would like to see it and I would like to see it rewritten to be broken down similar to how we handle crimes on people, and that be physical injury. That would be with a physical injury element, which in with people is assault, you know, third, with serious physical injury, which with people is assault in first or second degree, depending on how it's done, and then ultimately, you know, the murder of an animal. So I would rather see it done that way than to try to take things out of the ag and market law that make it difficult. That would be my position.
Chief, do you have some comments?
Thank you. I'm Chief of Police Mark Williams. I'm the chief for the city of Utica. We serve roughly a population of 61 or 62,000 people. I have 163 men and women on the police force, and we have one full-time animal control officer that we nearly lost during the last budget process, where we wouldn't have any. It certainly presents its challenges, and what we've had to do is reach out to other entities to get training for some of our police officers to fill in for our animal control officer when he's not available. But just to give you an idea of what we face during the course of a year, during year 2010, we roughly responded about 12,000 calls for animal control, and we saw about 46 arrests during that year. And last year, that increased to well over 1,800 calls. And again, we saw an increase in arrests, about 54. And this year, we're well on pace to exceed the amount of animal control calls that we're going on, as well as the amount of arrest. So the problem that we're having is certainly increasing. A lot of the cases that we come across when it comes to animal cruelty, believe it or not, are cases involving our drug investigators executing search warrants in a lot of these houses. Unfortunately, a lot of these dogs, especially the pit bulls, are becoming nothing more than tools of the trade for the drug dealer, who are trying to ward off anybody that may come into the house to try to take their stash and to protect it. And what we're seeing in a lot of those cases is the cruelty charges as well. I mean, last year alone, we executed over 150 drug search warrants here in the city of Utica. And, you know, we certainly saw our challenges. And again, the primary dog that we're, type of breed of dog we're seeing is certainly the pit bull that we're seeing. But just to highlight a couple of things that the other two speakers talked about prior to myself, I do agree that now the law should be changed to the penal law. When I first came on the job back in 1988, I didn't know that the agricultural market law existed. It took maybe 3 years into my career that I was studying for a sergeant's exam that I found about the agriculture market law, and more importantly, about the animal cruelty laws taboo. Since that time, you know, thank God, police training has changed dramatically. But even today, I mean, our officers do have access to the agricultural market law through their mobile data terminal, which is their computer in their car. But they have to search for it. You know, they have to do a search query. They got to know that it's in the agricultural market law to find it. So I think by moving it to the main law that we use every day, which is the penal law, it makes it simpler, more easy to use, and you tend to find that the laws in the penal law are the ones that tend to get the most attention when it comes to police academy training and in-service training as well. Other than that, I'm certainly open to any questions that you may have.
You talk about the number of cases. Can you tell me what percentage were actually neglect and abuse? I mean, you must get calls for other reasons. So sure. I guess what percentage would you consider were neglect or abuse?
I don't have those stats available. I can certainly get those for you. I will tell you this, is that, back about a year and a half ago, I instituted a new policy with the Utica Police Department, and we created a public information officer position. And what we saw is that whenever any of these animal cruelty cases, was put out to the news media, they go viral. And the phone calls to my office, I mean, they're not limited to Utica, New York. They're not limited to the state of New York. They're limited. They come in from all entities, including some other countries, and letters. So it's obvious that people are speaking. This is a serious concern, nationwide, worldwide. It's a serious problem. And I think likewise, we got to strengthen the laws and make it workable for the police officers to be able to properly charge that. There's always going to be challenges in enforcing the laws, because one of the things that you got to prove is intent. And one of the biggest problems you're dealing with a victim that obviously can't speak for itself. So there are certainly challenges.
Senator, you have a question?
Yeah, Chief. When you obviously many communities across the state are being financially challenged right now, So even though you have officers who are entrusted with that specific responsibility, so-called animal control officers in many communities, in many instances, you're going to have to rely on the rank and file also to augment that, because, as you said, you're never going to have enough officers that you may need
Absolutely.
To deal with the situation. So how do you prepare your department then to do that with adequate training, and what's the best approach? Because, again, you have fiscal challenges, but obviously you can't rely on one particular segment of the department or public safety to take care of the whole situation.
Absolutely. Just recently we had a outside animal, I forgot the name of the organization that came in and did in-service training for basically about five officers that volunteer that basically do the work of an animal control officer in his absence. What we've, in addition to that training, we opened it up to the Stephen Swan Humane Society organization as well. And one thing I would like to highlight with the Stephen Swan Humane Society, we have an excellent working relationship with them. They are phenomenal. They themselves have financial challenges as well, and we work well with them. But what's nice about specifically training several other officers to do the work of the animal control officers, now in those absences when he's not working his eight-hour day, we can now fill that void and have officers there specially trained to deal with these matters.
Let me ask a follow-up, maybe, and anybody can answer this, because I think you brought up an interesting point here, because we look at balance. We're here to try to protect animals, obviously companion animals, and that's what we're trying to gather information on and to determine the best course of action. But you brought up a point where animals are trained to be weapons, and then as a result you put law enforcement officers in harm's way, or potentially even community residents. I mean, how do we strike that balance there with owner accountability, and if an animal is trained to become and used against individuals who are trying to execute and enforce the law, too?
There is provisions of the penal law that do deal with it's in the assault section, I believe, they deal with an animal that's used as an extension of the owner to strike out as a police officer. The problem that we face is that we execute no-knock search warrants. So when we initially enter, first thing that's going to hear us is the animal. And the next thing you know, our officers are coming through the door and are faced with a charging pit bull most of the times.
I'm just asking, from prosecutorial or law enforcement, what else could we do with ownership? Because obviously there's got to be owner accountability, mm-hmm. too. And many of these are criminals. So, I mean, are there additional charges that can be put on?
Senator, I would think that you should have a law that specifically addresses the situation where people are using their dog to do and not make us try to make it work, okay? So, for example, if someone's using their dog to be a weapon and we're trying to prove it through an assault section, it's very difficult, because then you have within the middle of that, well, the dog did it on its own, I didn't intend it, and that becomes very difficult. Another thing is just the neglect and the mistreatment of the dog that goes on when they're doing that. A lot of times they're making these dogs mean. I've read different things. Pit bulls, not always by nature are a mean dog. They're made mean because they want them to be aggressive when people come in the back door or in the front door, as the case might be. So that all needs to be looked at if we're really going to have a serious discussion about, animal rights and passing laws that address these problems.
So it'd be owner accountability as well as animal rights.
It's like endangering the welfare of a child. I mean, we look at that situation when people, how they interact with children. The same thing, some form of that with a dog, I would submit, would be an appropriate, obviously it's going to be a lesser charge, but it should definitely be something that we could prosecute. Right now, it's very difficult to do that.
On that note, one of our best partnerships is with CPS and APS. We found out very early on that neglect is neglect, and whenever we see an animal neglected, we're usually seeing some child neglect and vice versa, and CPS knows that, and that's one of these professional relationships we've worked hard to develop. There's all these studies about serial killers coming out of animal torturers and gang activity coming out of dog fighting, and I've seen a lot of those links firsthand, but I got to tell you, I don't understand why there has to be so many studies to show that a violent person is a violent person and a neglectful person is a neglectful person.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Bill's going to testify. Bill, you want to come up, please?
Can I just thank some people in the audience right now for a minute?
Sure.
Senator Ritchie, while we're getting situated here, I also want to mention that we have many local advocates in our community out here today. The Stephen Swans Humane Society is here, Spring Farm Cares. Central New York Kennel Club is here. I want to thank all of the public who've come, but particularly organizations who have shown their interest and have provided written testimony. Thank you.
And the final speaker will be Bill Ketzer, Senior State Legislative Director, Northeastern Region of the ASPCA. Thank you very much for coming today.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, Madam Chair. Senator Griffo, Senator Valesky, Mr. Kuzniers. My name is Bill Ketzer. And like you mentioned, I am the Senior State Legislative Director for the Northeast for the ASPCA. I am actually fairly new to this position. In my previous capacity, I was a Deputy Commissioner of the Department of Agriculture and Markets. And before that, I was what I'd like to call a creature of the legislature myself. And so I know what goes into putting these meetings and taking them on the road, especially during a busy May legislative session. So thanks for the opportunity to be here today. I can speak reasonably confidently for our 200,000 New York members when I applaud your interest in learning more about the existing challenges in regards to companion animal cruelty, and also perhaps taking action to address some of the more problematic public policy issues we face today, which some of which were very eloquently described by the folks who preceded me. These laws are, you know, often the first and only defense for companion animals, and so I can't really stress the importance of a public forum like this to increase the visibility of these types of issues, so thank you. State-level anti-cruelty laws generally penalize two types of actions, and we've touched on that a little bit. So you have A, intentional acts, and B, the failure to act, or an act of omission, so to speak. So currently, only three states in the country fail to differentiate between the two and provide some sort of felony offense for the intentional aggravated commission of animal cruelty. In New York State, as also mentioned earlier, the intentional act of aggravated animal cruelty is a felony applicable only to companion animals. And this is more commonly known as Buster's Law. And this is Ag and Markets Law Section 353A. And the language of the statute was pretty carefully negotiated upon its enactment in 99, from what I understand, and is very prescriptive in that the offender must, and this is the definition, with no justifiable purpose, intentionally kill or intentionally cause serious physical injury to a companion animal with conduct either intended to cause extreme physical pain or is carried out in an especially depraved or sadistic manner. So there's a lot of intents in there, and it's a very tight definition. And perhaps in part due to the specificity of this law, many cruelty situations in New York more typically fall, of course, into the failure to act realm, and the general animal cruelty law is applicable to all animals and quite broadly scripted. And typically these violations carry a Class A misdemeanor and include, and again, this is a very antiquated statute, overdriving, overloading, torturing, cruelly beating, unjustifiably injuring, maiming, mutilating, killing, depriving of necessary sustenance, food, or drink, or willfully engaging, instigating, or furthering any of the above acts. But despite this expansive definition, the law does not specifically, in my opinion, and I'm not a prosecutor or an attorney, and I don't play one on TV, I'm, like I said, a creature of the legislature, but in my opinion, the law doesn't specifically include provisions for what is overwhelmingly the most common injustice humans inflict upon animal companions, and that is actual abandonment. In neighboring states, and in most U.S. states, abandonment is either kind of tucked in the definition of the state's cruelty laws and punishable under the same, or a broad definition of abandonment is provided that can include private premises. And, of course, as in all situations, you'd like to think, you know, these are broadly defined to allow for factual circumstances to determine criminal culpability. But New York, by contrast, interestingly, has a separate and distinct law on the books for abandonment of animals that has been determined to be applicable only to animals left to suffer or die, that's a quote from the statute, suffer or die in a public place. And that's Section 355 of the Agriculture and Markets Law. And Mr. Painter commented on how antiquated a lot of these laws are. And so this abandonment provision in particular was chaptered in 1961. So that's about 50 years ago. And the statute was most likely, I wasn't alive back then, but most likely was geared towards curtailing abuses of work animals. And it now is also readily applicable to situations where folks leave animals at shelters without formally surrendering the animal. I have the definition in the testimony. I'm not going to sit here and read the entire thing. But to me, unfortunately, what this means is that the abandonment law is kind of useless in an incident like the one here recently in Utica, where, you know, the eight dogs were found abandoned in a Whitesboro Street residence. So the owner has been charged, and someone can please correct me if I'm incorrect, but I believe the owner has been charged with eight counts of misdemeanor cruelty. That's the failure to act. And several non-criminal violations, and unlicensed dog, and things of that nature. But there's, I think, a significant missed opportunity here to, you know, if the abandonment law included abandonment of an animal on a private premise, that would be an additional separate and distinct crime that could be prosecuted under the Agriculture and Markets Law. And I like to think of that as more of an early intervention mechanism. I mean, as it stands now, the a law enforcement official cannot charge an owner solely on the basis that he or she has abandoned a pet in a residence, despite the potential and almost, and a lot of times, unfortunately, inevitable consequences if the animal is left unchecked. This is, I want to just stress the importance of it because, you know, neglect and abandonment are by far the most common crimes, according to a lot of different national organizations. I use as an example PetAbuse.com because they're a New York-based organization, but they're national, not-for-profit, and they compile animal cruelty information state by state. And you have a chart here. I couldn't bring my PowerPoint today, but you can see that on the chart that. Abandonment is by far the most common crime, and interestingly, right above that is animal hoarding, which is a topic for another hearing, I believe. For many years, Assemblymember John McEnany has attempted to close this abandonment law loophole with this year's bill is A-1878. This bill would make it abandonment applicable to private property. The Assembly Agriculture Committee reports this regularly, but it has actually never reached the floor for a full vote in that House. The legislation does not currently have a Senate sponsor. However, Senator Valesky, your predecessor, took this bill on for many years and was able to get it through the Senate. So I would be happy to work with members of this committee or any member of the Senate or their staff to take a harder look at the way these sometimes antiquated laws are constructed with an eye toward providing better prevention and response and prosecutorial tools for law enforcement. So in that said, I just wanted to talk a little bit more about other anti-cruelty proposals that are out there in the legislature right now. Todd, you mentioned Senator Ball's two bills. 5804, which would provide that no person convicted of a violation of Buster's Law, that's the felony cruelty, can own or possess a companion animal unless authorized by the county court following a psychological evaluation, and then also the expansion of the felony cruelty law to include harm to animals during the commission of felony. So thank you for reporting that recently. The other two I would just like to mention. There's a lot of animal bills in the legislature, as I'm sure you know all too well. These are general concepts that a lot of members have tried to tackle and have struggled with over the years. And so I'm just mentioning these as examples, as just general examples of these concepts. Assemblywoman Paulin from Westchester has a bill, A-269, which would make any misdemeanor cruelty violation within 5 years from the date prior. Basically, if you have been convicted of misdemeanor cruelty within 5 years and then you offend again, that would be a crime on the level of the Buster's Law statute. So that would be a Class E felony, or the lesser Class E felony, as Mr. Painter had described. In addition, and this one is actually new. It comes and goes, but I think it's actually very important to mention. It's not directly necessarily related to the cruelty statute, but Assemblyman McGee, the agriculture chair in the assembly, has introduced a bill that would prohibit the tethering of dogs to stationary objects or certain types of mobile devices. Pretty carefully scripted, pretty consistent with New York City's new law on the books as of, I believe, last year, and consistent with a lot of what other states are looking at. It basically provides exemptions for, you know, a lot of the obvious stuff, you know, veterinarian grooming and hunting and training and other types of activities. And this was a brand new bill, 10053, and also currently does not have Senate sponsorship. So certainly a significant degree of debate always surrounds the expansion of the existing cruelty statutes in the legislature, but public forums like this, I can't stress enough, are essential to further that discourse and elevate public visibility. So thanks to you all for being here today as well. I wanted to talk a little bit about the ASPCA's law enforcement resources that are available to municipal law enforcement officials. So in addition to the legislative solutions we just talked about, other means exist to strengthen the safety net for animal protection and show the public that New York means business when it comes to enforcing its existing animal cruelty laws. I'd be remiss not to make the committee aware of our outreach services as they relate to cruelty. We have an anti-cruelty group. The legislative unit used to fall under the anti-cruelty group was our government relations arm is now growing, and it has come out from underneath the anti-cruelty unit, leaving the anti-cruelty group to really focus on what it does. They have an actual contract in New York City to do humane law enforcement in New York City proper, but in addition to that, they provide professional education to law enforcement officials, and that's available on an as-needed basis upon request as resources as we're able to do that. The anti-cruelty group umbrella also houses a field services department which works with professionals in the veterinary, judicial, law enforcement, and social services fields to educate them on detecting, investigating, and prosecuting animal cruelty. We do this all over the country, and it's vital because a growing body of research is, of course, as others have talked about today, have documented the link between violence to humans and animal abuse. The ASPCA also recently announced the creation of a legal advocacy department to increase legal protections for animals across the country. This department is headed up by a woman named Stacy Wolf, who is actually my not immediate predecessor, but a predecessor. She was the former lobbyist for the ASPCA in New York State. She heads up our Humane Legal Services Department, and then also the Legal Advocacy Department. That's a lot of hats to wear. And they're going to provide second chair. This was recently announced, literally last week, but it's been in the works for quite some time. And what they're going to do is provide second chair legal support through the coordination of legal and other expert services that are vital to the effective handling of animal cruelty prosecutions, as well as conduct selective affirmative civil litigation cases in instances where the potential to affect substantial change in a given state exists and for a nationwide impact. So I'm going to provide you have my contact information, but I'll leave some cards as I leave. And I urge anyone to contact me regarding our availability for law enforcement training and any other services we offer in your districts and surrounding jurisdictions. Lastly, I was pleased to see in your press release announcing this hearing, Senator, that this week is Be Kind to Animals Week. And this is a great time to focus on, for everyone to focus on sharing love and compassion of animals, particularly with children. Since they, you know, they literally inherit our future, and humane education begins first at home and then can continue in the classroom. Whether it's volunteering at your local shelter, learning about how to report animal abuse, adopting a homeless animal, or simply just getting involved locally and advocating for change. I hope some of you here today will find ways to support programs that educate children to treat animals humanely and encourage others to do the same. So to close, in the last few years of the 20th century, animal welfare issues received a great deal of legislative attention. When I was in the legislature and for about 5 years prior, I was fortunate enough when I was the director of the Assembly Agriculture Committee, I was left a huge body of information, lots of different public hearings on companion animal issues. 40 miles from here, a gentleman named Michael Bragman, then Assembly and former Majority Leader, way back when was the chairman of the Agriculture Committee in that House and did a ton of work on this stuff. But recently, and there's many, many reasons for this, of course, but hearings and roundtables and other public opportunities of this sort have been few and far between, and that's a shame because in a prolonged economic downswing like we're currently experiencing and hopefully kind of creeping our way out of, a lot of bad decisions are made regarding pet ownership. So interestingly, the infrastructure for animal care and sheltering and other services are slowly changing as well as a lot of effort is being put into rescue organizations and formalizing the relationship they have with shelters. It doesn't sound controversial on its face, but it is an enormously controversial issue. And so that's coming up at the same time. So I really applaud your efforts to bring folks together here today to talk about this issue, and I hope I look forward to future opportunities in that respect. So I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you, Bill. Just for clarification, you were talking about New York City and education for law enforcement. Did you say that was available locally?
Yes.
Or just in New York City?
No, it's available. It's available to anybody who wants to request that. I'll take the information of anybody. What we do is our humane law enforcement division will go out into communities and provide educational seminars to local law enforcement officials. That could be county government, county sheriffs. That can be, we do state police academy. We do local police all over the state. In New York City, in addition to that, the ASPCA has long held the contract for the city to do actual humane law enforcement. So, and that's the only place we do that.
Thank you.
Quickly, putting your former hat on, we did invite the Department of Agriculture, but I think they were unable to attend. As a former deputy commissioner, is that the appropriate place for jurisdiction and responsibility when we do?
I'm like putting you on the spot.
The cameras are gone, right? No. I mean, and I'm confident to say that, and that's not a knock on the Department of Agriculture. The Division of Animal Industry has no law enforcement capability. They are not authorized in this state to prosecute, to investigate animal cruelty, and that would be, they have no jurisdiction over Article 26 of the Agriculture and Markets Law. So they often, you know, what happens is the legislature has given them some companion animal programs over the years. The only one that's left is the pet dealer program. A lot of folks call that the puppy mill program, but it's a pet dealer program. They go after who they can with the resources that they have, and what that means really is pet stores. They do very few breeders selling at retail.
We talked about the financial difficulties facing communities, organizations. We have a number of great organizations that are present here today, as I indicated. Do you, because they're also facing financial challenges, do you cooperate and collaborate with them to assist in trying to provide some of the things that you talked about, like training that maybe the Utica Police Department might need, and you could help the Stephen Swan Humane Society? Are those type of collaborations in existence?
I don't know right off the top whether or not we collaborate with Stephen Swan, but we do have a community outreach department, and which has recently kind of been overhauled. And so we do have a community outreach person who serves both New York and New Jersey. Jill Van Tile is her name. and she is the one who is the direct, that's the person that not-for-profit organizations, SPCAs, animal shelters can reach out directly
to. But there is a willingness and a possibility to also interact with our organizations who are, as I indicated, facing financial challenges too, that maybe as in a collaborative effort they could help communities, municipalities that may need additional training and other types of assistance.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I guess I'd be remiss too to mention that at the sheltering level, at the Humane Society, the local Humane Society, local SPCA level, the as a part of, if I'm going to put my old hat back on for one more minute, the 2010 budget, the Department of Agriculture and Markets used to have an animal population control program, and what that is it's funded by a surcharge on dog licenses. The department wanted out of the business. The 2010 budget got them out of the business and created a great, much more expansive program in terms of the types of eligible programs that shelters can apply for, and counties and municipalities are eligible as well. It's a five-year contract. The ASPCA has the contract, so as you can imagine, I'm going to be forbidden to work on that particular program pursuant to our ethics laws. But it's certainly there's no law disallowing me to promote it. It's a wonderful program. It's a over 5 years, a multi-million-dollar program. And during the off session, when I have my wits about me, we'll be out, especially in upstate New York, promoting the availability of that money to shelters and to municipalities.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I just want to follow up briefly on Senator Griffo's first question. You're certainly in a unique perspective, having worked in the legislature, worked at the department, and now doing the work you're doing now. previous guests here who certainly suggested strongly that we look at, in effect, moving the entire body of law from the agriculture and markets law to the penal law, notwithstanding the legislative challenges of moving an entire set of law that has been written over several years, and I understand that. But from your perspective, would that have a significant positive impact to look at something as dramatic as?
Based on, I thought that the testimony that preceded me was quite valuable. Based on that factual experience, I would say it certainly warrants attention. The ASPCA has supported that idea and concept for many, many years, but it wasn't only until recently where somebody like Mr. Painter in Nassau County really kind of took the bull by the horns, so to speak, and really tried to, it's not a bill you can write on a cocktail napkin, you know. You really have to go through this, and I've written bills on a cocktail napkin, so I can say that. But it really has to be done the right way. Mm-hmm. And as I believe I just mentioned, our Humane Law Enforcement Division is actually reviewing that right now because clearly the Senate means business in terms of advancing the bill. Mm-hmm. I'm not quite sure where the Assembly is, but at the same time, given the problems that boots on the ground law enforcement has, and given the fact that it's highly unlikely that a beat cop is carrying a copy of McKinney's in his glove box, I think it warrants a lot of attention. Sure, sure.
Thank you.
Sure.
That's all. I'd just like to thank you and Jed and the other two gentlemen for your testimony today.
Thank you.
Certainly appreciate your time and. I look forward to working with you and my colleagues here to help protect our pets and to move this issue forward. So while the public hearing is closed at this point, if there's anyone in the audience who would like to submit testimony for us to look at, have any questions, please feel free to contact our office either in Watertown or Albany. And thank you again for taking time out to come today.
Thank you, Senator.